Sven Soderlund from Regent. I want to reflect a little bit on Gordon's time at Regent College. But just to say that if we're supposed to trumpet credentials, I need to say that for 42 years I've been credentialed, ordained with the PAOC, which does not stand for peas, onions, apples, and carrots, but for the Canadian Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada. From September 1963 to December 64, I spent three semesters in the graduate program of what was then called Central Bible College and Seminary, pursuing a Master of Arts and Religion degree. So I did transfer down from the northern land of promise to Springfield for a bit. But after almost 3 years in Latin America, I came back to Canada to teach for 4 years, 1968-72, at Western Pentecostal Bible College in North Vancouver, and studied for 1 year at Regent College in 72-73. It was somewhere during that time that I first heard of Gordon Fee. Whether good or bad, I don't remember now, but it must have been very good, because when a little later I was completing my PhD degree in Britain, there was no doubt about who Gordon was and what he stood for. At that point, it was primarily his work as a textual critic that was to the fore. Only later did I learn about his famous Pentecostal Scholar on Fire reputation. But that reputation came in handy when I was back at Regent, this time on the faculty and in administration. We started an annual Pentecostal lectureship at the college, sponsored at that time by a Broadway Pentecostal Tabernacle in the city, where my brother-in-law was pastor, so I had a bit of an in to help that lectureship happen. We'd already had Bill Menzies and Russ Spittler as lecturers, and we're later to have Murray Dempster and Mel Roebuck, but it was time to get someone else. And so it was easy for me to contact both Bill Menzies and Russ. I had met Russ before a couple of times. But now it was time to ask Gordon, whom I had never met, and who certainly didn't know me from Adam. Nevertheless, I made bold to phone him up one day and ask him to be our lecturer the following year. To my delight, he said he would come. The year was 1984. As part of the lectureship, it was our practice to have the lecturer meet with the faculty. That was that year we met in our home, a group of judges. I think we were seven or eight. But among them were two of our systematic theologians, Klaus Bachmiel of blessed memory and Jim Packer. The discussion went back and forth on different topics, and Gordon was in good form, but so were the others, meaning that there were really positive vibes in the air and good chemistry in the interchange. I remember Gordon saying afterwards that the most amazing thing about the evening was that he had felt himself understood by these systematicians. An experience apparently rare occurrence. experience. When in the province of God, it did work out later for Gordon to come a couple years later to Regent, the full-time professor, fall of 1986. It was to a pair of old, dilapidated fraternity buildings that he came, which didn't give way to some new buildings until a couple of years later. But as for the Pentecostal lectureship, once Gordon came to the college, and later Rikk Watts, there was no further need of such a lectureship, since we now had a daily Pentecostal lectureship. The entire New Testament department coming from that background. One of the first things I remember about Gordon at Regent was his frantic effort to put the finishing touches on his 1 Corinthians commentary. For the purposes of finishing that commentary, the move from Boston to the West Coast had come at a most inconvenient time. But somehow, in the scramble of it all, while settling into a new house, a new city, beginning a new set of classes, Gordon managed to do the final editing and send it off to the Herms. The later extraordinary reception of the commentary suggests that he got it more or less right. How appropriate then, though, that for the second edition, that it just came out in time for this convention. But if the first edition proved to be a challenge to complete with the move and attendant complications, This was as nothing compared with the hassles of getting the second edition through the editorial and printing process. At least that's the way I've heard it from Gordon the last couple of years, this having been an exercise in frustration and patience of unheralded proportions. But back to Gordon and his experience at Regent, something we've already talked about. His manner of teaching soon became legendary, even in a non-Pentecostal school like Regent. I've had students tell me they shook in their boots the first couple of classes with Gordon, thinking he was shouting at them because he was angry. But he soon learned that it was rather the release of what I call disciplined passion. They soon learned, too, that it had nothing to do with the old chestnut about the preacher putting the marginal note in his sermon script, "Shout loud, point weak." For if any of Gordon's points, for none of Gordon's points were weak, it was because they were so strong, they needed emphasis. And of course, the joke among the faculty was that we didn't need to go to any of his classes to know what Gordon was teaching. Because we could all hear it by sitting in our office on the second floor.
Nobody could ever believe that.
It's a bit hyperbolic, but you get the point. But if Gordon sounded like a lion at times, at other times he was mild as a lamb. I remember different times at faculty meetings and faculty retreats how Gordon would pray with such tender and broken spirit, we were all moved to tears. So the fire that burned in Gordon's soul just expressed itself in different ways depending on the circumstances and context. But with a mention of faculty retreats, I mustn't neglect to mention the several such retreats we spent on Galliano Island off Vancouver mainland coast at Gordon and Maudine's family cottage, which was something more than a summer cottage by the lake. In fact, it was rather large city house overlooking some of God's most beautiful west coast scenery, and still does. But how a poor Pentecostal preacher could afford two houses on the West Coast always amazed Gordon. Something he wouldn't have had the business sense to negotiate on his own, so he says. But was all due to the providential rise in real estate value in Boston area before, between the time he moved there and left. But to underscore the sense of humble living with which he and Gordon, with which he and Maudine had been accustomed, I still remember the light blue little Civic Mini that with which he pulled into Vancouver, having driven it all the way across the continent from Boston. And not only did it make it across the continent, but lasted a good few years after that, if I remember correctly. As for the house on Galliano Island, it is still always there for its biannual gathering of the Fee clan. Next time around, being, of course, without the presence of the matriarch, Maudine. But not only did Galliano House serve as the venue for faculty and family retreats, it was also the place providentially provided to give birth to Gordon's other major works, namely God's Empowering Presence and Pauline Christology. The birth analogy is not inappropriate because since for the former of the two, we would occasionally hear back from over the waters about Gordon's agonizing struggle to give the work shape and bring it to completion. But the gestation period and birth process, difficult as that was for that book, obviously produced a very healthy offspring, since from all reports that one has heard about it being helpful to students as much as any of the other previous works, including 1 Corinthians. But given Maudine's passing a few days ago, a couple of comments about her seem appropriate here as well. During the early years at Regent, Maudine contributed in her own significant way to Regent College community, both as a counselor and as a retreat speaker, and of course as hostess to many student gatherings. Maudine testified herself to a significant physical and emotional healing associated with the move to Vancouver. And I believe that she found a new lease on life in her various strategic involvements there. Famous in the community were also Gordon Maudine's wedding monthsversaries, originating, as was commonly reported, in Gordon's famously having forgotten a particularly important anniversary, and so it always became the monthversaries. Now, the authenticity of which I cannot vouch for, but what I can vouch for, though, is the way, the extraordinary way indeed, in which Gordon and Maudine worked together as a team. In prefaces to books, we often read appreciative remarks about a spouse's support for the laborious purpose through which a book has passed. But in the case of Maudine, she not only bore with Gordon's intense work schedule, she also heard every word read out loud and had to sign off before he could send anything to the publisher. Many a time she would say, "Gordon, you can't say it like that." And of course, her obliging husband would always obey. That's why the books read as well as they do. Well, Maudine was a remarkable woman, and I respected her highly. Whether the fact that she came from a thoroughbred Swedish stock had anything to do with it, I'm not sure. But it was interesting that she and our oldest daughter, Karina Lucia, had their birthday on the same Swedish Lucia Day, December 13th. And so it was an easy day to remember, and I sometimes phoned up Maudine to congratulate her. What is certain is that it was Maudine that I first shared with the idea of fest script for Gordon. This was 5 years before his 65th birthday. She was the one who gave me the suggested names to contact, and she was the one who kept the project completely mum to Gordon. So as far as I know, unless Gordon tells me differently, when we, together with Tom Wright, presented the book to Gordon in May 1999 at a public event, it took him by complete surprise.
Speechless, in fact. A normal moment.
And the reason Tom was involved with the project was he had come to Regent different times, summer schools, and needed someone to give credibility and name recognition to the project. But also because of Tom and Gordon's mutual respect for each other. The book, which then was printed by Erdmans, the book went into soft cover editions, which usually doesn't happen with festschrifts. But because of Gordon and name, I think it had something to do with it. In fact, at one point it was selling so well, we were half expecting a movie contract. Somewhere around that time, we heard that the Erdmans had wisdom to ask Gordon to become F.F. Bruce's successor to the NICNT commentary series, and we rejoiced with him. Through several of those years, Gordon also served, of course, as the NIV Revision Committee, together with his colleague Bruce Walkie, and not infrequently, I remember hearing about the struggles and not so pleasant shenanigans associated with that complicated project. The other contribution that Gordon and Maudine gave to Regent was, of course, the Charette, who came to study there between 1994 and 97, and would like to have said more of Charette here. It was a sad day, though, when Gordon retired from full-time teaching at Regent in 2003. An even more sad day, a few years later, when he and Maudine pulled up roots from the city that had become their beloved home, and moved back to the East Coast, this time to New York, where their sons, Mark and Craig, were settled. Gordon Maudine had viewed the time in Vancouver as a providential gift, not only because they enjoyed the time at Regent, but because also, by coming to Regent, they both were able to return close to home, close to their family homes, and help attend to their aging parents, in the case of Gordon, his father in Kirkland, Washington, in the case of Maudine, her mother, in nearby Ferndale. But finally, in 2010, the time came for a changing of the guard again, and they moved back to the east. What a privilege it has been, Gordon, to know you and the family of members that I've known, and now this morning finally met Mark and Craig. Thank you for your ministry. Thank you for coming to Regent and for blessing us and changing the lives of many, as Murray said. Thank you.